In this lesson, we deal with a special functional equation that allow us to build some interesting models. In particular, we present the problem of designing a cover of a sports building and the most general bivariate distribution with normal conditionals that is an important problem. The functional equation will be called the sum of products equation because it involves sum of products of two sets of functions. Another very common functional equation is what I call the sum of products equation. And it is because we have two sets of functions. One are function of x and other are function of y. And then you multiply them, we add up all of them and the sum has to be zero. The theorem we present next introduces the functional equation and provides its general solution, which can be constructed very easily. The equation forces the sum of products of two sets of functions, f and g, to be zero. The f functions depend on a single variable x and the sets of function g depend on a single variable y. The condition of adding up to zero forces some relations among the functions for it to be possible. As you can see, this theorem explains us in detail how the general solution of the functional equation is. First, we write the sets f and g functions in the form of column matrices, as indicated in the slide. Next, we have to build two column matrices, the phi 1 to phi r and the phi r plus 1 to phi n, that will be the basis of two linear spaces to which the f and the g function will belong to. Connecting these matrices by means of matrix products, we have two intermediate matrices with elements a and b respectively. The main problem here is the selection of the basic matrices, including the phi functions, that must be a total of n functions. In other words, we must decide how to distribute the n functions between the f and the g matrices. To this end, we need to analyze the sets of f and g functions to determine the required linearly independent functions that generate both linear spaces. Do not get afraid, because we will explain next how this can be done with the two examples following. The reader should understand this theorem before continuing with the lesson, in order to learn in deep what this theorem says. In order these sets of functions f and g to satisfy the functional equation, these intermediate matrices must satisfy the condition in the slide. That is, the product of the first intermediate matrix transpose by the second intermediate matrix must be the zero matrix. As indicated, we introduce first the problem of designing a cover with polynomial cross-sections. Assume that we have been asked to design a cover for a sports area in such a way that its associated construction process will not be very difficult. To this end, we look for a cover with second-order polynomial cross-sections. In other words, we look for the most general function C of x and y such that all cross-sections with planes parallel to the reference planes are second-degree polynomials, i.e., such that the conditions stated by the two equations below are satisfied. Since both must provide the same equation, we subtract them and make them equal to the zero function. Note that this equation must be satisfied for all x and y values. This is a functional equation where the unknowns are the functions a, b, c, d, e, and f. Note also that each term is the product of a function of x and a function of y, where a constant function 1 is considered in the third term, to be a degenerate case of a function of x and, in the sixth term, a degenerate function of y. Thus, we have our sum of products functional equation. To solve this equation, we apply the previous theorem. First, we write in column form the sixth function of x and the sixth function of y as indicated, with the corresponding signs. I suggest the reader to check that they are correctly written, the functions and their signs. Next, we must analyze the set of the six f functions, looking for linearly independent functions. A look to the functions 1, x and x squared reveals that these three functions are linearly independent, and that the other three functions, which are unknowns, could or not be necessary to generate the six functions,
because they can be generated by the first three. Thus, a minimum of three functions must appear in the column matrix of the right-hand side of the first equation. The same can be said for the functions appearing in the left-hand side matrix of the second equation, in which the function minus y squared, minus y, and minus 1 are linearly independent, and the other three can be generated by those three. Thus, in the right column matrix of the second equation, we can include these three basic functions removing their signs. Since we have three basic functions from the first equation and three from the second, we have a total of six, which is the number of terms in our sum of products equation. Thus, according to our theorem, we cannot include more. Next, we must build the intermediate matrices that we know must be 6 by 3 matrices, in order to be able to multiply the involved matrices. The first three rows of the upper intermediate matrix form a unit matrix because of the coincidence of the three functions in the left and right hand side matrices. The rest of the elements are unknown, and then we use A with two subindexes to refer to them. In the intermediate matrix below, we have a unit matrix change sign because we have change signs when building the basic column matrices on the right. Finally, the rest of elements of this intermediate matrix are unknowns, and we use B with two subindexes to name them. This concludes the application of our theorem in its first part. The reader should understand this before going further. If you remember, our theorem imposes some constraints to the coefficients of the two intermediate matrices, that is, the product of the first matrix transposed by the second must be the null matrix, which implies as many equations as elements the product matrix has, which in this case is 3 times 3 equal to 9. Writing the product of the matrix as indicated and obtaining the product matrix, we obtain the 9 equations on the slide. Know that they express the B unknowns in terms of the A unknowns, and then our solution will depend on 9 parameters. If we reparameterize, that is, rename the lowercase a and b unknowns as uppercase a, b, c, d, e, f, g, h, and I, and use the column matrices we had at the beginning, where the a, b, c, d, e, and f function appear, we get these functions, which replace into the C function, give us the equation of our second degree polynomial cover we were looking for.
That can be solved, and even we can obtain very nice covers as the one in the figure.
Our next example is the problem of finding the most general bivariate distribution with normal conditionals. This problem was solved during my sabbatical stay at Temple University with Professor Janos Galambos. We tried to obtain all bivariate distributions x, y such that the conditionals of x given y and y given x are normal distributions. This implies that if we consider the bivariate density of x and y as a surface, when obtaining their cross-section, similarly to the cover example, we will get intersection shaped as Gauss bells. If we denote the joint marginal and conditional densities as indicated in the slide, and write the joint density as the product of the conditional of x given y times the marginal of y, and as the conditional of y given x times the marginal of x, we get the expression in the slide. If further, we rewrite the conditional function as normal densities with means and standard deviations as function of x and y, respectively, we get the expressions in the lower part, but we have omitted the normalizing constants and use the proportional to instead of the equal to relations. After substitution, taking logarithms using the u and v functions and rearranging terms, we get the expression indicated that must be zero for all x and y values. Note that this is our sum of product functional equation that has six terms. To solve this functional equation, we apply our theorem, as we did with the polynomial cross-sections cover examples. First, we obtain the six function of x and the six function of y appearing in the six terms and write them as column matrices as indicated. Next, we identify three functions of x as linearly independent. If v of x is non-zero and three linearly independent functions of y, if the z function is non-zero, and write them as the basic column matrices on the right-hand sides. Finally, we build the intermediate matrices where we can identify two 3x3 matrices with coefficients 1, minus 1 and 0 and unknowns denoted as a and b for the cases of functions of x and y respectively. Finally, we write the constraints that must be satisfied by the intermediate matrices, that is, the product of the first matrix transpose by the second must give the null matrix as indicated by the theorem. If you develop this product, you can find the unknowns b in terms of the a unknowns. Replacing these unknowns and reparameterizing as before, we get the expressions for all the unknowns function and the joint density of the most general bivariate density with normal conditionals as indicated. The parameters a to j are not arbitrary, but must satisfy one of the indicated set of conditions for the density function f above to be a valid probability density function. This means that we have two families of models. The first model is the well-known bivariate normal model with linear regressions, constant conditional variances, and normal marginals. The second model has no linear regression lines and no normal marginal distributions. The mode is at the intersection of regression lines. The following figures show an interesting particular case.
I obtain a very nice result. First, I obtain the classical normal densities that have of course, conditionals that are normal, they have marginals that are normal, and they also have linear regressions, as you can see in the figure. But I have found also another family, which is not the standard normal, that gives other examples, of course, satisfying the condition that they have the normal conditionals, but the marginals are not normal anymore, and the regression lines are not straight lines. Even you can get examples very simple as this one, which are very nice. This is a very strange example, but you can see that it satisfies the conditions stated, and of course the marginals are not normal and the regression lines are not straight lines.
In this lesson we have seen the sum of products functional equations and some interesting applications, mainly the one related to conditional distribution characterization. It is interesting to realize that functional equations allow us to simplify models by imposing properties of these models that reduce the complexity of the functions involved. With these examples, we suggest you to think on possible applications to your own field of specialty. I invite you to follow the next lesson dedicated to other functional equations, in which we present a model for crack growth, the Euler formula for polyhedra, and one artificial intelligence application to the diagnosis.